I'm so happy to be talking about this book right now, and because I keep thinking that the issues here are, you know, in a way they represent, you know, whatever work I've done till now, the insights from that work. But also they speak to a lot of things around us today. And to me, in a way, I can hear a voice in the back of my head in whatever situation I'm in, whether it is the anti-CA and PR-NRC protests, or the current, you know, COVID-19 situation and the pandemic and the way in which citizens are viewed by the state and women are viewed by the state. In all those, I can hear a voice in the back of my head kind of reminding me about the insights in this book and what they say to us about that situation, and kind of changes the way you look at your own relationship with the government, with the state, and with society. So, you know, without too much ado, I think I'd just like to start with, I've just selected four short excerpts just to share with you. What I thought I'd like to begin with is basically the cover of this book, because I'm kind of in love with it, because this is a painting by Amrita Patil from 2016, from her book Soptic. And I'm so thrilled that she was happy to have me use it as the cover of my book. And this is basically a picture of the Abhisarika Naika. It's a modern interpretation of the Abhisarika Naika. So it's Amrita Patil's interpretation of the Abhisarika Naika. And so what is the Abhisarika Naika? It is one of the Ashtanaikas in Indian art traditions, where, you know, that is the heroine, you can say, who is inhabiting eight different states of emotional being, right? So this particular Abhisarika Naika is the heroine who is heading out through the dangers of the night. And there are all kinds of dangers. There are snakes which are holding on to the feet of these women and all of that. And there is this ghostly form which looks like a female form in the back, you know, trying to basically seem scary or call back the girls, call back the women. And yet they are making their way into this dark night where there's lightning, lightning bolts and all of that, because they are making it out to meet their lover. Okay. So I think that, you know, that image stands in for so many things, including for the fact that you basically pursue your desire in spite of fear. So, you know, to me, it really encapsulates what I mean when I say fearless freedom. That I'm not trying to say that we need to have no fear. It's natural to be afraid, and fear is with us. Fear is with the Naikas in this painting as well. There are things to be afraid of, and yet, in a way, fear is your companion, and you are not expected to restrict yourself or restrain yourself or confine yourself in the name of that fear. So fear and risk is part of one's life as a human being, and a part of one's life as a living being on this earth, and you are there to, in a way, revel in it, enjoy it, accompany it into to meet your desires. And your desire is not just some female form waiting for a male lover, but for anything that you want to pursue, anything that you deeply desire and deeply love. So it could be research, it could be education, it could be a job, it could be travel, it could be anything at all. It could be activism, it could be anything at all. So I just want to start with the conclusion of that book, in which there is a little bit about the Abhisarika. So I've written here that we need women to be Abhisarikas today, with their desires for lovers, yes, but also for the simple pleasure of a walk on the street or a cup of chai at a street corner, for reading and research, for adventure, for wanderlust, for andolans, for revolution, to light up everything around them. And when many women become Abhisarika, these streets and the dark nights will be much safer. Imagine a woman alone on the street at night, and we imagine danger. But imagine a street full of women going about their own business and pleasure. And to women, such a street immediately seems safe. So that was the first excerpt which I wanted to read. And then I wanted to get to basically my first chapter, where you know, on page 10, basically, I have tried to discuss the sort of hard facts that underpin the book. So the hard facts include this very, very stark fact from the National Family Health Survey 2015-16, the latest National Family Health Survey. And, you know, when I say fact, then you can't kind of argue with this fact, The fact is a fact. How we interpret it is another matter. So it found that just 41% of Indian women aged between 15 and 49 are allowed to go alone to the market, to the health center, and outside the community. Okay. And accompanied with this is also data which shows that a very large number of women, 26% of women and 16% of men, justify wife beating, domestic violence, if a wife were to go out of the house without telling her husband. So that's one fact. And then also the to me the fact was surprising that it did not seem as though Dalit and Adivasi communities had very different situation when it came to freedom of movement for their women. And I tried very hard to struggle with that fact. And then I came across the India Human Development Survey, IHDS study, which makes a distinction between women being able to go out alone and women having to seek permission to go out. So, and that makes it kind of clearer that even if women from Dalit Adivasi communities or educated women and so on are employed, they can go out of the house, but they're expected to ask permission. So it says better educated women make more decisions in the household and are able to go more places on their own. However, there is less evidence that they can go without asking for permission from someone in the household. So this whole thing about asking permission is extremely important. Women are expected to ask permission of some authority figure in the household and men are not. And then I wanted to read this little bit. If you think education makes for greater freedom for women, you are wrong. Because this is something a lot of people tell me, that, oh, isn't education the answer? As long as there's lots more education, all will be well. Not quite. Education contributes only marginally to freedom of movement. 42.9% women with no schooling and 45.3% women with 12 years or more of schooling have freedom of movement. So there isn't that much of a gap between women who are educated and those who are not. So what do these facts and figures really mean? They translate to a life lived crashing against walls, like a bird caught in a closed room, battered by every attempt to escape and fly free. There's really no way to dress up this life and romanticize it as quote unquote safe, as the only life where one's quote unquote honor is safe. Such intense and obsessive confinement of women is not safety. It is time we recognize it as violence in its own right. The cautionary tale of the Lakshman Rekha, which we've just heard our Prime Minister talk about in the context of the pandemic, the cautionary tale of the Lakshman Rekha distracts us with the fear of the evil Ravana lurking in wait if women breach the quote-unquote circle of safety at their doorstep. It makes us forget that to be confined within four walls is to be prevented from living life fully, to be condemned to the suffocating existence of a caged bird. Two more small excerpts, if there's time. Yeah, two more small excerpts. So I wanted to talk about the Beti Bachao. I wanted to read a little bit about the Beti Bachao campaign and the self-help groups, because this is a chapter called Empowering Women. And it's asking the question about the government schemes, basically, because governments, a lot of people tend to say, oh, why are you so negative about government efforts? Be positive. And I try to say that, no, it's in fact the government efforts that are negative in a feminist sense, because they are not investing in the capacity for societies and for people to change. They are invested in using patriarchy, in basically leveraging patriarchy to fix this or that so-called problem, which they think is a problem. But they are not interested in challenging or confronting patriarchy. It's almost as though they believe that Indians as a culture, as a society, can't be expected to question patriarchy. We, in fact, feminist movements are the positive ones, because we firmly believe that change is possible, that change is happening, and that people can make change, that people have progressive values inside them. And you just need to, for those values of each other to connect with each other and build on our collective strengths. So I wanted to read out this little bit. I've basically mentioned these slogans from the Beti Bachao campaign, which say, "Kaise khaoge unke haath ki rotiyan, jab paida hone nahi doge betiyan." who will make rotis for you if you won't let daughters be born? And similar slogans, beti nahi bachaoge to bahu kahan se laoge? If you don't save daughters, where will you get daughters-in-law? Maa chahiye, behen chahiye, patni chahiye, to beti kyun nahi chahiye? You want mothers, sisters, wives, then why don't you want daughters? This sounds like an appeal to common sense, but perhaps it is not effective in curbing sex selection, and it is not because India's sex selection ratio is still abysmal. Perhaps it is not effective in curbing sex selection because it is an appeal to a patriarchal common sense. Should we be asked to appreciate daughters only as performers of domestic chores? Is a daughter's right to be born and cherished dependent on her role as a future mother, daughter, sister, daughter-in-law, or wife to men? And there I have basically talked about the Selfie with Daughter campaign, which began with the Skap Panchayat leader of the Bibipur Panchayat in Haryana called Sunil Jaglan. He ran an organization called the Avivahit Purush Sangathan, the unmarried men's organization in Haryana. A woman must justify her birth by making herself available as a willing wife stroke daughter-in-law who will cook, clean, give birth to, and care for children. But men feel entitled to wives who will serve them and bear them kids. So nothing drives home the utter arrogance of such patriarchal entitlement more starkly than the phenomenon of bride purchase. Jaglan complained in an essay that I have quoted, in a story that I've quoted, Jaglan complained that the men of Haryana, faced with a drought of daughters, are forced to buy wives from other states. A couple of months ago, he said, a family had purchased a bride from Uttarakhand. She ran away. They bought another one and she too ran away. Jaglan implies that wives born and trained in the correct caste in Haryana and acquired in the traditional way rather than by cash purchase will not have the option of running away. After all, where would Haryana's own women run to? Many defend such campaigns arguing for pragmatism. People are going to continue to be patriarchal, they say. So one has to appeal to their patriarchal interests to allow girls to be born. If individual patriarchal families want to avoid girls, perhaps they can be induced to allowing girls to be born in the collective interest of patriarchal society, or so the argument goes. The problem is that as long as women are devalued and denied personhood and equality, patriarchy is not particularly insecure. Brides are, quote unquote, in short supply in Haryana. But this shortage can be made good by importing from other states. As long as daughters in, say, Bihar continue to be treated as commodities rather than as persons, families will sell daughters to their counterparts in Haryana. Just as migrant labor goes from poorer to richer regions, purchased wives too tend to go from poorer to richer states. So from a pragmatic perspective, it could well be argued that a shortage of women in Haryana turns a daughter from liability to asset in Bihar, since she goes from being a burden to an asset that can be sold. Is that really true? Are daughters accorded more respect when they become a saleable community, a commodity rather than a burden that one can only be rid of by paying dowry? So this was one. And then one small, very short bit that I want to read out before as my last selection here. This is about the self-help groups, which is also kind of what a lot of people believe is basically a form of empowerment because it is giving women access to affordable loans and allowing them to be self-reliant economically, or that's how the theory goes. A study by organization Nirantar in 2007 found that for self-help groups, as for microfinance institutions, MFIs, it is, quote unquote, it is not the interests of women but their vulnerability that makes them attractive loan takers. So senior district bureaucrats in Gujarat explained that women make good debtors because unlike men who may, quote unquote, disappear for days, quote unquote, women can't go anywhere. They can be located easily. They cannot run away. That phrase again, they cannot run away. They cannot run away, leaving their homes. They can be persuaded to repay easily as they feel shame more quickly and consider non-payment as a betrayal of family honor. The Nirantar study found that the self-help groups were using, quote unquote, existing gendered norms relating to a sense of shame and honor to create peer pressure on women to repay the loans. So I just wanted to read out those bits and now open it up for conversation.
So yeah, I think you've sort of given us a really good overview of some of the themes that your book engages with. And for me, the big one was that your book is invested in expanding sort of the traditional notion of violence, right? So to go from including only the sort of public grotesque forms of sexual violence that get media attention, and then you know, have a death penalty awarded to the rapists, right? To go from seeing only that as violence to seeing what you call violence that's hidden in plain sight. So the violence that we commit in our families, in our societies, that the state also commits against the women of the country, right? So I was interested in whether you could say a little bit more about why that kind of structural approach to understanding both violence and the autonomy of women from that violence is important at a time when there's so much emphasis on women's individual choice, right? Even if, like you say, it isn't particularly threatening to the patriarchy, the particular choice that the woman makes. So if you can say a little bit about that.
Sure. Well, I think that even if one's own individual choice is threatening to the patriarchy or whatever it is, I don't think that social change should be seen only in terms of incentivizing individual decisions. Mm-hmm. That is a neoliberal framework, and that is a very familiar sort of framework of liberalism that says that basically, you know, individual self-interest is what is paramount. But the point is that, you know, that sets up a situation where women are forced into women or, you know, various oppressed sections or marginalized sections of people are forced into competition with each other. So the point is this whole glass ceiling approach, you know, that if a woman has to break the glass ceiling, then she has to compete with other women and men. So it's a competition, and you're accepting that competition is the order of the day. Why can't we think that everyone needs to rise together, that you don't need to have your foot on someone else in order to rise yourself? Mm-hmm. But, you know, in the words of this very beautiful film called Salt of the Earth that I remember, it's a 1950s film, please look it up, called Salt of the Earth. It's available on YouTube to watch. So in that, there's this migrant woman in America from a Mexican background. And she is telling her husband, you know, they're all in the strike together. And the husband is trying to do this dadagiri over his wife. He's uneasy with his wife coming out in and becoming more of a leader in the movement. And she says, why do you need, you yourself are oppressed by so many others. Why do you need to have your foot on my neck? When I rise, I want everyone to rise with me. I don't want to be, you know, have my foot over someone. So that's exactly what I mean. That, you know, when you think about a social transformation as a whole, then you have to understand, you know, what is it structurally that is preventing that transformation? And how you don't need to just look only at individuals and how to incentivize individuals to change, but also how to look at the socioeconomic structure of society as a whole. Also, when I say this, I mean that you should not separate the economic and the social. The social and economic are not in two separate boxes. They're not in two separate dabbas. They are, you know, they are embodied in each of us. And so you have to look at social kinds of oppressions and economic deprivation and exploitation together. They reinforce each other and they are basically part of the same structure. Mm-hmm. So that's basically one of the points I wanted to make. And just related to that, if I have time to respond on that, I've been thinking lately even about, like, you know, the examples I read out about the SHGs and the Beti Bachao and all of that. Mm-hmm. I feel that those insights speak to us even today. When you look at the response, for instance, to COVID-19, okay, because say you need to have a situation where people understand the need for physical distancing. Granted, I don't think there can be any argument on that. That is something we would all agree on across the world. But the point is that for states, including the Indian state, but not only the Indian state, the Chinese state, Indian state, the American state, so many states have seen it as an Hungary just now. So all of them have seen this as an occasion to ramp up the state's power, you know, draconian power, to basically punish people for violations, to threaten people, to beat them up, to humiliate them publicly, and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. And all this is what we are seeing around us. So the, you know, so the entire thing is how to shame people. And in Beti Bachao Swachh Bharat also, it's the same. So the idea is that you go around terrorizing people, shaming them for open defecation and all of that. And that is the only way that we think change can happen, because you're supposed to be encouraging people to change, but you're encouraging it through the, you know, danda dikhakar ke, basically. You are just trying to threaten them instead of believing that they're capable of understanding first principles, understanding how open defecation is related to health, jeopardizes our collective health, or that, you know, not observing physical distance at such a time could jeopardize us all. It could result in so many deaths. Instead of banking on people's ability and willingness to understand this and then help each other to implement this, you are banking only on draconian steps. And just briefly, I wanted to share something in that regard, that I was reading Atul Gawande's book, Better, recently, which is his notes as a field notes as a surgeon. And he talks in his first chapter about hand washing, which we're all obsessed with that now, right? And he says about how medical infections result in so many deaths in hospitals. And then he talks about one hospital where they reduce medical infections to zero, deaths by medical infections to zero. How? He says they took a different approach. They actually asked janitors and nurses and doctors and so on, what do you think? They didn't tell them, you have to do this. And if you don't do this, this is the punishment. They said, what do you think we need to do in order to make sure that everybody washes their hands much more, so that patients who are here for some other condition don't end up getting infected by the doctor or so on? Well, janitors and nurses came up with so many suggestions. They said, no one's ever asked us till now. No one has asked us about this. And here are our suggestions. You should do this. You should do that. They gave a whole host of suggestions. And then the nurses felt empowered to tell off the doctors if doctors were not washing their hands properly. Apparently, nurses always wash their hands very properly. So he said, well, that succeeded. So a more democratic approach, where you actually tell people the problem, let them understand the problem, and allow them to come up with solutions, would work a lot better than the sudden overnight lockdown. If you were to have discussed a month, you know, January 30th, when your first COVID-19 case came, if the government were to have called all stakeholders, trade unions, opposition parties, state governments, whatever, and said, let's ask women's groups, let's ask various kinds of sections of society, sex workers groups, trans persons. Okay, we're going to have this trouble possibly coming up. What do you think are the best ways in which we can face this? What are the preparations we need to do so that you don't harm people in order to protect them from the virus? We protect them from the virus, but we ensure that they don't die of other, you know, hunger and various, and of police beatings and so on. This is the approach I'm basically talking about in my book. So it's not just about these particular problems. It's more of an approach, a more structural and democratic approach to problems that I was talking about.
Yeah, no, this is incredibly helpful, especially what you said in the context of COVID-19, because it helps me sort of transition into my next question, which was about, you know, you're in the book, you're also invested in critiquing patriarchal notions of protectiveness, like you read, right? And that is what allows one to make claims that, you know, women will somehow soil a family's honor, because it's only when these notions of honor exist that there exists shame, like you were talking about earlier. And, you know, I was wondering whether it would be worthwhile to sort of maybe reimagine or re-envision protectiveness as maybe a universal ethic of care, where, you know, we all both need care and provide care. And then, of course, there are people who perform specialized forms of care, labor or work, and that would then perhaps allow an alleviation of their labor as well. So I was wondering whether that distinction between protection and care is one that you think is valuable, or perhaps does it, you know, lend itself to co-option by the patriarchal, nationalist, state-centric model a bit too easily?
No, I don't think so at all. In fact, I would not even jettison the word protection or protectiveness. Mm-hmm. I would only say that we need to disconnect it or uncouple it from the notion of restrictions on women, right? Mm-hmm. So protection is just fine as long as it is coming from a place of respect for that person's autonomy and decision making and their right to take risks, right? So as long as I'm protecting you shouldn't mean, okay, I'm entitled to tell you what to do and what not to do. As long as it doesn't mean that, of course we should protect each other. So in fact, even Raksha Bandhan and all, I keep thinking about how we can reimagine it, because as a, not as a shackle, but as a bond, right, where siblings protect each other. It could be a beautiful symbol of siblings' love for each other, siblings protecting each other. And in what ways could siblings protect each other? You could protect, your brother if he wanted to come out as gay or as trans. You could protect each other. You know, so the point is that protection then means that you are actually protecting that person's personhood. It's not just this macho sense of protection, but a sense, as exactly what you said, of care. And I also think there that it's about reimagining care as a society. You got that absolutely spot on, right? It was in my mind too. That care as a society also, that care basically involves so much labor, emotional labor, the care work that we do, which we call, sort of social reproductive work. So social reproductive work is the work done to reproduce social relationships and what we understand as society. So all kinds of work like sanitation, which is crucial work today, sanitation work, medical work, education work, work. So this is inside the family as well as more generally in society, right? All the work that it takes to cook, clean, care for, make sure people, ill people are taken care of, people receive the kind of medical care that they need when they need it, and so on and so forth. Even something simple like PPE gowns for the ASHA workers and the sanitation workers and the doctors and the nurses, okay? Which is it should be obvious. Why does it take a pandemic for us to start saying across the world, whether it's the USA, the richest country in the world, or India, which is one of the richest countries in South Asia, to stand up and say, oh, our doctors don't have here. Why? They should, right? So the point is you're prioritizing something in the name of protectiveness. We are probably prioritizing defense and, buying all kinds of jet planes and buying all kinds of warlike equipment. Even during the pandemic, we have spent money buying arms from Israel. We don't need those now. Nobody's about to wage a war right now. You could have at least now prioritized buying the equipment, the ventilators and the other care equipment that we need, right? So I think prioritizing care and reimagining care and democratizing that care, asking ourselves, who does this care work? How do we change that? Why do Dalits do most of the sanitation work? Why do women do most of the care work inside the home? How do we reimagine that as a society? Can't the state take responsibility for a large bulk of care work? Can't we have more community kitchens always, not just during a pandemic? All those things.
Right. No, that's absolutely right. And just before we continue, a quick announcement that I want to make for the listeners' benefit. Of course, feel free to start sending your questions on the side. I see some people already have. We'll take them in about maybe 15, 20 minutes. But don't worry, I can see everybody's questions. so we will get to those shortly. So my next question, which you sort of alluded to when you were speaking about, who does that sanitation work? And this relates to something you say in very clear terms, and I really appreciate how clearly you state this, is that caste is at the very center of Indian social order, right? And that controlling women's autonomy then becomes a patriarchal project because of that need to protect that social order at the basis of which lies caste. So maybe if you could say a little bit about how caste is implicated in all of this, and also maybe illustrate with the help of some of the examples you use in the book.
Sure. Well, I think that the very fact that we keep needing to say this, okay. So on the one hand, we are told over and over again that, oh, it's only, if you ask a room full of students, for instance, and I've done this very often, and many of my friends have done it who are teachers. If you ask a room full of students, they'll say, oh, caste discrimination is a very bad thing. And then you ask them for an instance of caste discrimination, and they say caste-based reservation. So the the one of the remedies to a problem is being seen as the problem. And then they will tell you, but we were never aware of caste until we came up against reservations. So yes, if you are from a privileged caste, you had the privilege not to be aware of caste because you were not reminded of it every day, right? We are not reminded of caste every day if we come from privileged caste. As simple as that. So I think that this is something which, and I marvel at the fact that the same people who will say, oh, caste doesn't exist anymore. It's only because of reservations that it continues to exist for vote banks and this and that. And then the same people will turn around and will not miss a beat and will not miss a single opportunity to tell you what a wonderful thing caste is. So when social distancing is being talked, I prefer the term physical distancing and social solidarity, even when it comes to the pandemic. But I was with appallment. I saw that social media was awash with people, including so-called Indophiles who were, foreign, non-Indian people who claim to be enthusiasts of Indian and Hindu culture in particular. And they promptly came up with this bullshit saying, oh, look, when the Indian order did it, untouchability in the name of caste, people said it's a bad thing, but look, now we all have to do it. So I'm not talking about untouchability based on birth, but no, you wouldn't, because that sounds bad, right? But then she goes on to say, the person I'm talking about goes on to say on Twitter that no, but I'm saying it's a good thing to distance from people who do unclean work. What is unclean work? This is cleaning work. Okay, so sanitation work is actually cleaning work. Dealing with dead animals and so on is cleaning work. It's not dirty work, it's clean work. And it's cleaning work. So this is what comes up over and over again about Swachh Bharat and all that. If you don't address this elephant in the room, how on earth are you going to address any of these problems? You know, it's an open secret and well established with research that people defecate in the open in India a lot more than they do in Bangladesh or Pakistan or similar countries in Africa and so on. Even poorer countries in Africa and so on, because in India, it is associated with the notions of purity and pollution associated with caste. So the idea is that if you have a toilet inside your home, you're going to have to clean it yourself, and that's a dirty thing to do. You shouldn't have to do it. It's different to have flush toilets, but if you have to clean out a pit toilet once every 6 months yourself, it's no longer defecation, it's no longer feces, it's no longer shit. It's perfectly, it becomes composted, basically. You can easily clean it out. And yet people think it's... So you have to engage with that. You have to go and talk to people about caste then and about why this is not dirtiness and instead it is cleanliness, right? So, but that's not happening. Similarly, when it comes to women, I think the idea is that you'll talk about everything else. Like people will talk about rape and people will talk about death penalty and all kinds of useless stuff. But they won't want to talk about the fact that so many Indian households are obsessed with the idea of policing their daughters, surveilling their daughters, and policing their daughters' friendships and social behavior, because they are terrorized by the idea that she may fall in love with somebody from outside the caste or the community, or in the same gotra or whatever, violating the rules of the caste, basically. And this is something which is exploited by right-wing politicians. It is exploited by dominant caste political groups. And this is not just some old hangover. This is recreated and reinforced by modern political forces. If anything, in society, there is some change because people are falling in love across these boundaries and borders and are saying, get lost, we're not going to bother about that. But there is caste-based killings and so on happening in the name of honor, precisely to terrorize, people into keep holding on to those caste boundaries all over again.
Yeah. So, my next question was about the anti-CAA protests that burgeoned towards the end of last year. And then the current state of affairs is, of course, difficult given the breakout of COVID-19, but I know that you were involved in those protests and also, of course, heavily involved in the anti-rape movement of 2012. So I was wondering, how does this current moment, the anti-CAA movement, How do you read that in the context of women's autonomy, and also whether you see any connections between this moment and the 2012 movement that you were a big part of?
I'm very wary always of just trying to collapse one moment or one movement into another. So I won't do that. And I know you're not asking me to do that. But I think that just in terms of one thing which I do see as something that is in continuity with that movement, the 2012 one, is the the fact that these are women-based, it's a women-led movement and not India's first women-led movement. So, you know, media is always very quick to say, oh, this is the first one, this is the first time this, first time that. Not at all. In 1980s in India, you had, in Delhi, for instance, you had the anti-dowry movement. And I love to talk about this in all the Shaheen Baghs where I've gone. That when you remember Fatima Sheikh and Savitri Bai Phule from long ago and their friendship, do also remember and commemorate Shah Jahan Appa and Satyarani Chaddha, whom I talk about in the book as well. Two women who lost their daughters to dowry killings and then, you know, came out on the street, became friends and were lifelong friends, fighting to make other people's daughters safer from dowry killings, right? And they did this in this Delhi. They led that movement. They were ordinary women. They did not have any, you know, traditional sort of, they were not university educated or anything like that. And they led this remarkable movement, and what wonderful foremothers they were, right? So I think that to me, when I look at the women of Shaheen Bagh and look at how women of so across ages, you know, so elderly women as well as very young women, very young girls, they're all out there and they are out, you know, handling it's crazy, because I know that in ordinary times, when I go to, you know, places, then I sometimes have to push women to speak in public. Mm-hmm. So they'll be hesitant and they'll be shy and then they'll say no. And a lot of people will then not have the patience to allow them the chance to conduct things on stage. They'll say, "Theek hai, stage pe aake do shabd bol degi, but chala nahi payegi," and all that. And now, for whatever compulsion, suddenly you go to these places and everybody is like a pro. They're running these stages for hours on end. They're able to balance, you know, who to call, who to ask to speak, who to ask to shut up, who to tell, you know, who to call, when, how to introduce them, this, that, and the other. Everybody has something to say. And they are so fluent in what they are saying, right? The number of people I've heard giving brilliant speeches, and they're not tali pitwane wali speeches. The speeches that are explaining and making sense, they have something to say. Okay, I think that is one important thing to recognize. And the other thing I feel like reminding every time I go to the Shaheen Baghs also, I was reminding this. I used to ask people, "Acha, bahut mushkil hai, bahut sari cheeze, you're afraid of the police, you're afraid of so many things, but tell me one thing, are you having fun?" And then there would be this big smile all around and people would say, "Well, yes, actually, yes, we are making new friends, we are spending so much time here, the care work, at least a part of it is being taken care of by the guys back home. And even at this protest site, a lot of the care work is being taken care of by men. And so you are able to kind of stretch your wings and find time to make friendships and find time to discover your leadership." So I said, okay, suppose CA wapas ho jata hai kal and NPR NRC nahi hota hai, band ho jata hai. Then what next? You would not just go back to the women you used to be. You have come out here and you have become someone else as a collective. And it is necessary, while the physical Shaheen Baghs may not be there if these battles are won, but you need to imagine these places and continue to have these movements for different things, because that is where you're nurturing solidarity, you're nurturing a sense of history, you're nurturing a sense of constitutional morality, all these things, you know. So these women are doing that now, and they will continue to do it even if this particular battle is won. They will continue to fight the war.
Yeah, and collective action is certainly a very important theme in your book that also strikes at sort of the very heart of this neoliberal consciousness that has emerged, that, like we were talking about earlier, sort of promotes individual empowerment over solidarity among women. So thank you for saying more about that. And my last question before we start taking questions from participants. So again, feel free to send your questions in the chat. So my last question is actually about literature. And at the start of your conclusion, you have this wonderful quote by James Baldwin, which says, "You write in order to change the world, knowing perfectly well that you probably can't, but also knowing that literature is indispensable to the world." So I was wondering if you could say a little bit about what is the power, this indispensability of literature or writing that you also value.
Absolutely. I think that because I was someone brought up as the daughter of someone who was a literature enthusiast and a teacher herself of literature and a student of literature. So basically I was brought up with a lot of books around me in several languages and reading and writing around me a lot. But I think that, what I feel is that I tend to think in terms of instances and examples from books. So the people I meet in books or the instances I meet in books are, I don't always have to go look for a reference. I may go look for the reference just to tell you, chapter and verse, exact page. But those people I've met in those books are always there. So the point is, if I'm talking about, like I do in the book, I'm talking about Shalu from Meerut. And to me, the idea of Mela from the Harper Lee book, To Kill a Mockingbird, just comes very naturally. Yeah. And I do think that's important in terms of, all of us live lives which are in some way confined by our circumstances and so on and so forth. So in order to expand our heads, not all of us will be able to travel widely and have know people across continents and so on and so forth. But the point is that books help you do that, fiction, non-fiction, both. They help you to imagine, put yourself in the shoes, walk in the shoes of other people. Mm-hmm. And so you it expands your, it's good for your brain and your heart both, because those expand, they become a little stronger. They don't, they're a little quicker. When they see something that is strange to their cultural sensibilities or whatever, because you have read about these things in so many places. So even if, around you, culture may have been very, as it was in my case, absolutely. I mean, it's a very homophobic culture, certainly when I was growing up. But the point is, because you had access to literature and you knew that there are worlds out there and there are movements out there, and there are people out there who live life differently and where homophobia is recognized for what it is. So, you realize that you are able to look at these things a little more differently than someone who is not exposed to these things yet. That is why I think that, this is a book club, and it's great that reading books, disagreeing with books, arguing with books, going back to books, rereading books. There's a friend I have who's always very surprised that I reread books. So, he's like, "Acha, wo sab to pulp hoga na," that kind of thing, because these are, paperback books or whatever. So he's like, "Why would you reread something?" So I said, "No, I may not always reread a detective novel, but there are so many books which it is lovely to reread, because you are, those are familiar parts, and you, even a children's book like Watership Down, which Richard Adams wrote for children, is something I keep going back to. Okay, quite recently, when this girl was, this very young woman was arrested from the anti-CA protests in Karnataka, Amulya, because of a slightly ill-advised slogan that she said in the most well-meaning way. I remember that I spoke to a friend in Bangalore who was helping to get legal help for her and so on, and was also a little exasperated with her. And I told him that, she's a little like a character from Watership Down. So I told him that she's like Nell Tilta from Watership Down. And for those who've read the book, they would know that immediately. So that's the way I tend to think. And I think that it makes us better person. But,
Oh, that's fantastic. And it aligns perfectly with what we believe as well, which is part of why we're really glad that we could collaborate with you today. So let's start taking questions. Does that sound good?
Yeah, just fine.
Okay, great. I'm just scrolling up to the first question that was sent to us. Yeah, I believe this was by Trivika. So before she asked her question, she said, four excerpts and the cover page insight into each has made me tempted to read this book written with such new perspective. My question is, how will this lockdown and pandemic impact either positively or negatively women in our country and globally?
So, you know, how it's going to impact is one question. And also the question is about whether at all women are being counted in whoever is planning things in this pandemic chaos. All right. So I think that quite recently some friends of mine drafted this brilliant letter to the Delhi Chief Minister, which I think could be and should be modified to, you know, be submitted to all other chief ministers and the central government also. And also, you know, it could even be modified to fit other countries. But the interesting thing is that it's such a detailed letter, and it is going bit by bit over who are going to be impacted by the pandemic and by the lockdown. So the fact that so many, you know, the bulk of informal sector workers, or the bulk of women workers in India are in the informal sector. Health workers, sanitation workers, a very large number of them are women. And so naturally, the conditions under which they are having to work in this pandemic, those conditions need to change. Those conditions should have been different already, but this pandemic should at least be a wake-up call to say, if nothing, at least now, let's stop wasting money on NPR and NRC and you know, throwing away money on waiving loans for big corporations and spend that money to make sure that people have PPE kits, for heaven's sake, and enough testing, for heaven's sake, you know. And then if you look at the impact of domestic violence and so on, which across the world, everyone knows that, you know, it's very clear that domestic violence goes up in situations of such confinement. Again, that links up with my book, which is all about confinement and what that means for women and how that does translate to violence for women. But I'm also interested in the fact that, you know, I'm always surprised by how, you know, so-called experts basically just miss what is being talked about here. So just this morning, there's a story in the Deccan Herald on domestic violence, which cites me, which quotes me also. But it also quotes someone who is a so-called relationships expert. A man. And I was completely jolted to see that this person, you know, that the article has a subheading that says men too. Yes, we know men also can face domestic violence, sure. So I began to read with interest, all right, is that someone who's going to talk about that? And I realized that this guy is saying, their so-called relationships expert, is saying, look, men are not used to being confined in the house. So they're confined in the house. And then on top of it, when women start aggressively demanding that they do chores, household chores, that makes them very vulnerable. Okay. So I was like, oh, really? In a piece on domestic violence? And this guy, I reached out to the journalist also. And he said, oh, you know, I just was supposed to quote so many people and this was an expert. I said, what expert? Expert on what? Expert on rationalizing domestic violence? Or what is this? What relationships expert? If he's going around telling women they should not aggressively ask men to do household chores, even when they have nothing else to do, even when they are locked up at home. And the idea that confinement for men is somehow the special torture for women is very normal. I used to be confined. You know, this is complete such, you know, bullshit, basically. So this kind of thing also is what is going on. So it's not just that there is the domestic violence, the way in which the violence is not recognized for what it is. And then, of course, the other impact in terms of the social care work, which is the women are going to do a lot more of because of the lockdown, because of the pandemic, because of the economic destruction. You know, the world is being dug up. You know, it's going to be, you know, it's going to be a mess. So I really think that I'll just end my answer, my reply to this question by saying that I feel that, of course, while things are going to be terrible, and things are going to be terrible for a very, very long time, and of course, especially so for women. But I just think that, you know, if things have really been dug up by the roots, we shouldn't try and put them back in exactly the same way that they were. We should start demanding some change. We should say, acha, now that everything's dug up and we have put things back, let's have a say in how things are going to be put back put healthcare first, put care work as a priority. How much are you going to spend on healthcare? At least this pandemic should stop, should ensure free hospital care for every individual all across the world. Let international governance on healthcare at least be collaborative, and not commercialized. All these things we should demand, and that would make an enormous difference to women's lives as well as other things. And also, as I said, I think the approach to problems that we, instead of asking the state, giving the our fear of a disease or our fear of terrorism or fear of something shouldn't give the state a thicker and bigger danda to beat us. Mm-hmm. Instead, we should say, no, the bigger and worse the problem, the more afraid we are. Yes, we have the right to be fearful. Fearless freedom doesn't say, oh, you better be fearless or else. We all have fears. But the point is that how can we address those fears without wanting to restrict the freedoms of others, disrespect the freedoms and human dignity of others, without asking people to do, murga on the street and slapping them silly because they've stepped out for milk or whatever it is. Or failing to understand why migrant workers are having to walk back home and so on. Just have basic respect for human dignity in whatever problems, however fearful the problems that we have in this world, and we have many, let's find a way to face them in a more democratic and more cooperative way.
Right. Thank you for that answer. And thanks for your question as well, Shivika. The next question is from Meenakshi, who's asking, do you think that economic freedom along with education for women will bring fearless freedom to us, as in to women?
Meenakshi, I'm so glad you asked that question. Actually, there's a chapter in the book where I've discussed this somewhat, because I think that it's not so easy an answer. The point is that even women who have a degree of economic empowerment and education both, they still have to ask permission to go out, and they still face the consequences of a society that valorizes confinement. Okay. So what does that mean? That, for instance, suppose you say, what is an economic empowerment? Earning the right to earn. So suppose you have textile workers, garment workers, who are earning in factories. They're important earning members of their household. They do earn. They do have a degree of empowerment because, there they are earning a living and supporting their families. And yet their position as women, as shameable persons, as persons who can be shamed by saying, oh, you look like a street worker, like a street woman, you look dirty, you look, rapable, or you don't look rapable, whatever it is. These kind of words are used to these women every day. Not only that, garment workers in some factories are prevented from having mobile phones. Because why? Oh, because safety. It's for their own safety that they shouldn't be able to communicate freely with the world outside. And they should be cooped up, they should be caged inside their workers' hostels, and then just go to the factory, work, and then go back, not have a social life. So the point is that even women who are economically empowered and who are going out there to work, their workplaces are structured by this, this basic structure which underpins both households as well as workplaces in our country, right? Which assume that we have a right that some authority figures, be it the state, be it the families, whatever it is, households, that they have a right to restrict women's autonomy and freedom, right? That freedom is conditional, and that in the name of protection, we have a right to endure. So I think that, whatever it is, even if somebody is economically empowered, that empowerment, comes into being fully only when that, the woman has a right to do whatever she likes with that money, that she's earning. And also, again, which I said in the beginning and in the answer to Manjari's question, is that economic empowerment is not just for individual women, right, in competition with each other. So in the self-help groups and all, women are encouraged to compete with each other, not cooperate with each other. So the idea is that if the other woman can't pay her loan for some reason, you have to collectively go and peck her to bits and shame her to bits so that she pays the loan somehow. Okay? So instead of imagining it empowerment like that, why can't we imagine it quite differently, as all women having an equal right to an access to resources, not just to individual money in their individual pockets, but the right to land, the right to water, the right to forest, the right to, and not to individual ownership, but community, access to those resources. as communities, as people in general, and generally a notion of economic well-being rather than prosperity as is usually imagined. So well-being of women, not at the cost of other women, or not at the cost of men, or not at the cost of this or that, but at basically for everyone, which will of course mean at the cost of corporate privilege and corporate big capitalist, the capitalist system as a whole. Oh yes, it'll be at the cost of that, but it won't be at the cost of.
Okay, let's now move on to Koyal's question. And this is something, you've touched upon before, but of course, if you have anything to add to this, of course, the framing is novel. So she says, to what extent then can consent be seen as independent from hegemony? Isn't there a very thin line between consent and hegemony? Isn't consent also designed from or through hegemonic foundations?
Right. Koyal, you're absolutely right. And I think that is a question always, right? That basically hegemony essentially asks us to consent to the conditions that the hegemonic powers have created. So they don't just force it down you, and they're not doing it just through force or through terror, but they're asking you to buy in. They're asking you to agree. So that is what accounts, of course, for the large percentage of women who say that it's okay for husbands to beat their wives if the wives violate, these patriarchal rules, including those of those that demand that you take permission to go outside the house and so on. So of course that's consent right there at work, right? But I think that the issue is also that we should be able to recognize that this doesn't mean that the choice means nothing. I think it's more about recognizing that we need to, again, sort of widen the frame a little and look at it beyond that individual person's choice alone, right? So for instance, as I say, contexts matter. What are the contexts? How are people understanding their own role in society and their own decisions? How are they framing that? How are they understanding that? That matters. For instance, I say that, even something like a hijab, okay, or a bindi, this is something which can have different meanings in different contexts. And we need to be wary before simply hathore se, usko sar pe marne ke bajaye. So you can't just say, oh, objectively hijabs and bindis are patriarchal symbols. Yes, in some senses, in some ways in which they are used, oh yes, they would be, especially if women are under pressure to use them. And so of course you can say that, oh, she's choosing to use it, but she's under pressure to use it, so her choice is happening under that pressure. Patriarchal pressure is a given there, but the point is patriarchal pressure is a given for most things we do, including our decision to wear makeup or not wear makeup, including our decision to wear or not wear certain kinds of clothing and certain kinds of places, right? So there are all kinds of expectations of what kind of clothes you wear or not wear, which you meet for various reasons. Who knows why you do that? Some of the reasons could be patriarchal pressure. Other reasons could be your own judgment, right? So what is the mix there? What is working there is really, it's not for someone else to come and, judgily tell you what you're doing is wrong or right or whatever, right? Now, at the same, just to finish that example, somebody who is wearing, a bindi, to show the world that, all right, I am a married woman and I am not I'm a suhagan and not a, so maine sindoor pehen rakha hai ya maine lal bindi pehen rakhi hai, whatever. Okay, someone else who is not wearing it to show that, but wearing it, even though they are not married or not, not or widowed or whatever it is. And just think about it in terms of where, if they were living in a country where pinhead is a gal, okay? If you're living in a country where pinhead is a gali, which means basically wearing a bindi is a slur for Indian people, for Hindu people, Hindu Indian people, okay? There, people may wear the bindi as an act of assertion to say, yeah, absolutely, if you, I'm going to wear a bindi, and you tumko pinhead bolna jo bolna bolo, but I'm going to wear it, right? Likewise, the fact that there is so much Islamophobia and so much hostility to the identity of Muslims. I know a lot of Muslim women who say, even if I am, if I were not to be a very observant Muslim, my name and the fact that I'm born Muslim is enough for me to face all the discrimination that comes with being Muslim, right? So, you know, which is, I think someone told me this very sad thing about, I think it was about Manto, I think, who says to a friend who tells him, you know, you are here drinking with me and all of that. Why do you want to go live in Pakistan? You know, you're hardly a Muslim. Tum kutne bade Musalman. And he says, marne layak to hoon. I'm enough a Muslim to be singled out and killed. Like, so when people feel that way, they feel, okay, then I have to assert being a Muslim then. You know, so I will assert it in whatever way. One of the ways maybe to wear a hijab or whatever. And that is a discussion and an argument for Muslim women to make among themselves. Mm-hmm. I think that for non-Muslims to come and say objectively that is this and that doesn't make sense. Women come into the movement wearing all those things. We don't go and tell them, okay, first you have to get rid of these things. Not at all, not at all, in fact. And sometimes people decide to get rid of them. Sometimes people choose to redefine them in different ways. And sometimes people just wear them lightly, more lightly than they used to. Sometimes I've known women who've said, I won't wear the sindoor anymore, not for the usual reasons that, you know, feminists give, but because I don't want it to make a distinction between me and an unmarried woman. Let's be respectful of how women themselves redefine their symbols. And we know that hegemony may be operating there. But hegemony is operating with all of us, no matter what decisions we are taking about our choices. That's my feeling here, but we are happy to discuss it more. Yeah.
Yeah. No, that was a very clarifying answer. Thank you for your question, Koya. Let's move on to a question that Jay has relayed on behalf of Dharmesh. The question says, Lal Salam, comrade, I'm learning about self-help groups and how they work and had felt what you said about it but couldn't word it. Thank you for doing it. Now my question is, how do we ensure that self-help groups uphold queer feminist values and not patriarchal ones?
Yeah. You know, the thing is that it has happened in some places. So for instance, when self-help groups, so you're bringing women together, right? And then the rules of the game are trying to make sure that those women, although they look like they are part of a collective, a group, but they are actually in competition with each other and they are there to police each other, surveil each other, and pressurize each other, threaten each other, etc. You know, basically discipline each other, right? So I think that that can change because after all, women are coming together. So the point is it can't change from within the rules of the self-help group. The self-help group itself is not a structure which is by itself conducive to feminist organizing. I just think that like any workplace, if you look at the SHG as also a workplace, and if we are feminists who are organizing in that society and women who are working with us as part of a feminist movement begin to recognize that it shouldn't be our job to prevent, to make sure that the weakest economically and socially weakest member of our self-help group is forced to repay her loan, you know, is shamed into repaying her loan, you know, without any respect for where she's coming from and what the fact that some illness has happened in the family and she's had to spend the loan she took on that rather than whatever small business she was starting, right? So if women start thinking differently, then they could on their own kind of rework the way in which a self-help group functions. And they could also make demands of the state, which is to say that you give us bank loans with lesser interest rates, lesser interest rates. So you give us easier bank loans, make it easier for us to get bank loans. Why are you making, allowing a self-help group network to do this business about extending loans. Extending loans is important, but the loans should be affordable. The interest rate should be good for women and all of that. And to do that, you can make, so there are self-help groups that have raised demands to the government to change the ways in which these groups function.
Yeah. Great. I hope that answers your question, Dharmesh. So the next question is from Sai, who says, that the idea of protection from violence from a gender perspective have been cis women centric. So these laws have centered cis women. And taking this into consideration, how do we address the issues being raised by queer and trans folk on these laws not being inclusive enough to address the violence that these communities face? So I'll move on to the next one.
Yes.
The next question is by Arush. He says, I'm glad you spoke about certain forms of labor, particularly those that involve cleaning waste, are seen as unclean. Is this notion of uncleanliness not produced by a notion of universal human dignity that imagines the body as always already pure and clean? To begin with, I think he's asking. And so any form of work that makes the body vulnerable to contact with whatever we choose to designate as dirt automatically falls beneath that notion of dignity. So yeah, so the first question is about whether these laws that seek to protect people from violence cease women-centric and how might we gender trans folk. And the second one is about whether some notion of universal human dignity actually undergirds and enables notions of uncleanliness.
Right. Thank you so much for those two questions, because they are really quite a meal, actually. I'll try and answer briefly. Yes, absolutely. I think the laws and the way, you know, even when I use the word, you know, of course, my book does talk in places about how the patriarchal rules are evoked to apply to trans people and queer people and all of that also. But the point is that I think you're absolutely right that the laws, you see, it's not just that they are there to protect women. Studies of these laws, you know, feminist studies of lawmaking when it comes to violence against women, shows that part of the consideration of the lawmakers has been to regulate sexuality. It has not been only to protect women. It has been to regulate sexuality. So the notion of protection that is imagined in those laws is not a feminist one much of the time. Okay, even when, so they say, oh, then why do feminists engage with the law at all? Because we have no option but to. Okay, those laws are going to impact women. And so the feminist movement, you know, I'm quite, I don't agree with those who say that those of us in the feminist movement who have demanded this or that change in the law are basically governmental feminists or whatever. I don't really think so, because we're not invested in the government at all. We are not invested in the law. The point is, we know that that law is going to be something which is going to, which women in their everyday lives are going to come up against, right? So it's not about investing faith in those laws. It's about trying to make sure that all kinds of violence and biases are somewhat less entrenched in those very laws that are so-called there to protect women. Okay, for instance, I mean, if we say that, why do Indian laws refer to modesty? What is modesty? What does modesty mean? Violation of modesty. Okay, why should the law have such a phrase at all in legal terminology? Okay, we are saying that not because we think that if you get rid of that phrase, it's going to make the law all wonderful, but simply because we think that as it stands now, the law is actually, you know, that it is embodying something which we are fighting against. Or similarly for marital rape, for instance, the fact that the law derecognizes the idea of marital rape at all, same problem with it. Now, when it comes to, likewise, when it comes to queer and trans persons, absolutely, the recognition for, you know, just imagine the fact that violence faced by queer or trans persons of a certain kind used to be, you know, if they ever went to complain, if at all the complaint would be entertained, it would be entertained under a law that criminalized them, which was Section 377, right? So Section 377 was the law which criminalized certain ways of being, certain kinds of sexual orientations and sexual identities. And it's a law of colonial provenance that has been used historically to profile and harass trans persons. And yet that would be the law under which this would, you know, a rape of a man by a man, for instance, would be prosecuted. And the homophobia that would come up around that would be completely horrifying, actually, in the media coverage of that and all of that. Still, even till very recently, this is what is the case, although 377 is no longer has that kind of force. So I do think that certainly the law needs to be reimagined very completely. In 2012 also, we had argued that at least you should have a recognition that the victim in sexual violence cases is recognized as gender neutral. You should have a gender neutral victim. We were a little wary, as in some of us women's groups were wary of having an entirely gender neutral law, simply because we didn't want a situation in which men accused of sexual crimes against women are able to turn around and accuse the accuser and say, no, actually, I'm at the receiving end of this. That was one thing we were a little wary of. We think that, we need to go carefully when we make that change. But certainly, you know, recognizing that every person, irrespective of their gender, is capable of facing sexual violence is the first step. And the rest of the things, I think, vis-a-vis domestic violence, vis-a-vis the sheer violence that people face in society in terms of discrimination, the sheer violence that people face, the same thing, these restrictions on women that I talked about. My book also talks about that you have, you know, just in the same way that a woman who falls in love outside her community or caste faces violence, similarly, somebody who comes out as trans or comes out as gay, as queer, is also subjected to those forms of violence. And you have had courts on some instances refuse to respect the autonomy of those persons, the personhood of those persons and their chosen gender orientation. Just as women have had courts tell them, oh no, you're 25 years old, but you can't choose who you want to marry. You better listen to your dad, who go back to your father's custody and all of that. So we have a very long way to go. The legal system in our country is not something working to protect, is not structurally, again, this is not just about the fact that you just had a former CJI who was accused of sexual harassment and sat in judgment himself on his own case. I don't mean only that. It's not only about individuals. Structurally, the law as a structure is invested in protecting patriarchy rather than protecting women from patriarchy. That is a fact right now. And likewise, it is interested in protecting the heteronormative order rather than in recognizing the rights. And we know that, what better example of that than the fact that the Supreme Court, you know, that awful judgment in which they upheld Section 377 after the Delhi High Court had struck it down. And then later they had to be, you know, because of the privacy judgment, which was a very unusual constitution bench judgment, they had to go back and change their position. Yeah.
Great. So so the second question, which was about...
Oh, yes. I'm so sorry.
No worries.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
You remember?
I remember it very well. I have noted it down. I thought that in fact, Arush, I don't have an easy answer to that. I'll have to give it some thought, because I think that what you asked me made me think. I'm not very sure. Instinctively, I would say that, yes, maybe the notion of the human body as somehow being a temple and somehow the human body as being something that is pure in and of itself is one thing. I'm not, you know, very conversant with how other civilizations, but ours, have looked at this and whether there is a universal way of looking at the human body. I would have to do a lot more reading to understand that. I'm not familiar with that at all. But I do think that instinctively my feeling is that even if that is the case, and even if that creates some, that is part of the problem, I would say that there are two other factors also which are staring us in the face, nevertheless. One is, of course, class. The fact that a janitor in the USA, where there is no caste system, but the janitors will tend to be from Latina, or they will tend to be Latina women or Black men and so on, and they will tend to not be white persons or so on. So that the very fact that that is the case means that although there is no caste system there, there is some notion of these being menial jobs which are to be done by certain segments of the population, not by other segments. A. But caste in India adds a different dimension to it, which means that even if you are not actually doing that work, it doesn't matter what you're doing. But the very fact that you are born in that caste means that you are tied to that for life. You are tied to that caste identity, and whatever it brings in terms of discrimination and in terms of violence, you know, you are sort of structurally bound to receive that no matter what. Ideologically, then there's this whole business about purity and pollution. There's this whole notions about purity and pollution that are very much caste-based. And yet we deny that they are caste-based. So I'm just going to say, if I understood you right, that I don't think you are suggesting that we disregard caste in our analysis of this. You're simply saying that we should also look at a somewhat wider lens at this. But I would just say that, yes, we could and we should, and I am intrigued enough to think about doing this in the future. But I would just say that we should make sure that caste is also front and center when we are analyzing this in India, because it's right there. And now, finally, when we are beginning to recognize this, we shouldn't elbow it out of the way again and start talking only about universal, you know, philosophical ideas about the human body. So we shouldn't do that at the cost of the attention that this notion may finally be getting in.
So Saru has asked, hello, just an extension on occupational stereotypes. Often there's a lot of stigma around men taking care of kids, staying home, letting a woman be the sole breadwinner for a household. How do you think we can navigate this? So that's one question. The next question is by Jean, who has asked, hi, Kavita, thank you for this insightful session. My question is, in the beginning of the session, you spoke about women and the freedom of movement, which is surprisingly dismal even among women who are economically independent. What do you think men can do to rectify the situation? I don't think the burden of finding solutions should fall on women, because given a choice, I don't think any woman would willingly choose to be in the situation of being controlled. But the irony is also that I am asking you the question. Thank you. And I think this is our last question. Yeah, so this last question is by Bade Vyas. They say, hello, could you possibly suggest more reading material about women and spaces in addition to your book? So that would be a good note on which to end.
Yeah. Sure. Excellent. Yeah. So let me try and quickly answer those three. You're absolutely right that men also face these stereotypes. And I remember, for instance, my dad, you know, I've written about my parents in this book, and I've written about my dad, especially because I felt, you know, that this is someone who was not, you know, he was an engineer. He was very much born in a caste privileged background and all of that. And he was not traditionally woke in any sense of the word. He hadn't access to, he had never read the, you know, books that could have made him woke or whatever, you know, none of those things. But the point is that because he was such a loving, you know, that love in a way brought him to a place where he wanted to respect what his wife and two daughters and his wife's mother and so on represented in so many ways. So I remember this one thing about, you know, my mother's colleague at school, he was a school teacher. He walked into the house, he was much younger than my dad, but he walked into the house and he saw my dad chopping wood, and he burst out laughing. And I remember feeling very weird about that. Why did he laugh, you know? And then and my dad seemed very unfazed. He never talked about it. He never looked fazed by it at all. He just continued doing what he was doing and looking as normal as ever, never said a word about it. But I remember that gradually when it dawned on me, this guy finds this perfectly normal sight in my household as being odd, as being laughable. He thinks this is a joke that a man is chopping vegetables, you know? And I remember that at that time, that guy was in love with some girl who he used to secretly meet at our place. And I remember thinking, even as a child, that arey yaar, ye to pyar karke shaadi karne wala hai, and he thinks he's doing something very brave and whatnot. And then he thinks that the wife is only going to do all this work. He's never going to touch all this, you know. So I think that these stereotypes do affect men, because patriarchy encourages men to be laughed at for doing these things. Absolutely, you're absolutely right. But I do think that you know, that they are beginning to change. I've come across, you know, in regular life also, just, you know, or men tending to find pleasure in doing things which earlier they used to be laughed at for doing. And I do think that, you know, we should make, you know, everything a kinder place. Feminism can make the world a kinder place for men also to discover these things about themselves. And it doesn't help that relationship so-called experts say, "Arey, ye to aggressively bol rahi hai, domestic chores karo and whatnot." You know, this is all nonsense. We should try to shout out that nonsense a little bit and give more space for men also to talk about their experiences of parenting, of their feelings towards children, of their feeling towards the fun that they might have in inhabiting different aspects of themselves. Yeah. Okay, quickly. What Jean asked about, you know, what can men do, basically? Well, the one thing which I would say is really the big thing that men can do is to talk to other men. Okay, I think that is really crucial. And I'm very serious about this. I think I'm so glad you asked me the question. And I think it's a very important question. And I think that men who become woke tend to spend too much time then talking wokely to women. Okay. And then it descends into mansplaining and whatnot. And that's not necessary. You know, you don't have to keep showing a woke card at all. You know, with women, you can, you know, you don't have to do that. I know very few men who take the time to talk to boys and other men about these issues. Boys and men may not open up to women, but they may open up to you as a man. And so it's your job, I think, men's job, to basically talk to other men about this and create, you know, just as we have a women's movement, we need a men's contingent of a feminist movement that is actually there talking to men about all these very many issues that we have covered. And the last question you asked was?
So reading material about
women. Oh, reading material, right. So actually the book, my book also has some pointers in that direction. But I think that one of the books which I enjoy and which I found useful, which you may have or may not have already read, is Why Loiter, which is written by three friends of mine who were at college with me. And they have written this wonderful book which reimagines what feminist goals can look like. And it's about loitering as a feminist goal. So that may be one starting point. But I also think that it's not just about women in space. I would say that, you know, my book also has, if you look at the notes section of the book, basically it has pointers in the direction of reading almost everything through the lens of this, you know, keeping autonomy front and center. Mm-hmm. So you can read about, today we didn't get to talk that much about that, but talk about conflict areas, talk about conflict, talk about political conflicts in Kashmir or in the northeast of India, talk about violence against women, talk about parenting and the whole Mother India kind of concept and how we can reimagine a politics of parenting. All those things, there's a lot of, reading suggestions in a way. You could take all the notes basically as reading suggestions, you know, because they are pointing in the direction of much more that one could read to better understand better understand the world that we inhabit and better understand the concepts that I've been discussing. I don't know if that's very useful, but
no, it definitely is. I would have recommended Why Loiter as well. So I'm glad you mentioned it. And yeah, I mean, you have a lot of very interesting chapters in your book. Of course, like you mentioned, there were some that we didn't get to discuss. There's one whose name I like very much, which is Where Women Are Worshipped, Can Women Roam Free? So if that interests you, I think all of you should go get this book. I found it incredibly sharp and lucid at the same time, which is rare. And sure, so before we close, just to quickly sort of throw in two comments that people had left on the side. Shivika shared an article about you having said that vulnerable women could have been moved to safer places if the government had given a warning of the lockdown. So yes, that's one article that Shivika has shared. And Atria says, just a thought, the constitution as well as laws have not even been translated to the recognized Indian regional languages. One glaring way in which it has remained inaccessible to those who don't understand Hindi or English.
Yes, yes, absolutely. Excellent, you know, spot on. I think the article that was shared is actually the one with that relationship expert whom I mentioned.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Great. Well, we can all look at that.
Yeah.
But yeah, thank you so much to all of you for sticking with us and to you, Kavita.
Thank you all. Everybody who was here.
Yeah. And if anybody, including Kavita, has feedback on how Belong could have done this better or wants to be a part of our network, feel free to write to me at contact@belong.net or Manjari, Manjari, @belong.net. So thank you all and take care. See you.
Take care. All of you take care. Yeah.